I'm reading for the book, How to Give Away Your Faith by Paul E. Little. In 1974, in Lausanne, Switzerland, almost 2,500 individuals came together for the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization. Prior to that meeting, Paul Little was the program director who was charged with putting together all the vast number of documents and groups and speakers and texts as they considered how to win the world for Jesus Christ in their generation. As I read this to you right now, there is going on in Korea, Lausanne 4, the fourth General Congress on World Evangelization. It brought to mind my meetings with Paul Little, who was my mentor and counselor in my seminary days, how he brought us together as a small group every week and read the scriptures and studied the scriptures and prayed together, how he asked us as a small group to pray for him and his wife Marie and all the others who were moving to Lausanne, Switzerland in preparation for this great Congress, how we met together there in Switzerland during the great days of the Congress and all that followed thereafter. I had been moved when I read as a university student Paul's book, How to Give Away Your Faith, and was able to teach it in my university in an InterVarsity Congress that we held there. This was all prior to the Lausanne Congress in 74. I'd like to dip into a more updated edition of the book that was put together by Marie Little, put together by InterVarsity Press, and I'll start in chapter 3. As we view the entire life of our Lord, we can learn many things from his encounters with individuals about witnessing and relating to people. Let me say what's going on here. This is Paul Little's analysis of John chapter 4 that I found life-changing. He talks about how do we give away our faith, and he talks about how Jesus did it with the woman at the well in Samaria. As you recall, Jesus said, I have to go through Samaria. And as his disciples went into the city to find something to eat, Jesus was at the well by himself, and this woman came out to get water in the heat of the day. And this is the conversation that Jesus had with her. So Paul uses this as the way, as the model that we can all use on how to give away our faith to others. Above all, we see Jesus' untiring concern that others hear his message. We can discover some basic practical principles to follow as we try to represent Jesus. From there, Paul Little writes, I hope we can consider how we might apply these principles. For the first principle, let's see how Jesus began. 1, contact others socially. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now, he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria named Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour when a Samaritan woman came to draw water. We read that in John chapter 4, verses 1 to 7. The first principle is one we covered in chapter 2 in this book. We must have social contact with non-Christians. Our Lord sat down at the well in the town of Sychar in Samaria, a place where he would have face-to-face contact with non-Christians. He was not enclosed in a bubble, surrounded by bodyguards. He was in the middle of traffic, so to speak. With the woman at the well and with other people, we see Jesus taking clear-cut initiative to get close to someone. He noticed a tax gatherer sitting at his desk, headed straight for him, and said, "Follow me," Luke 5, verses 27 and 28. When some of the self-righteous Pharisees saw this, they were really incensed. Jesus actually went out of his way to associate with sinful people. In effect, they said, "Oh, just look at the kind of people he's talking to and even eating with. Why, he's a friend of tax collectors and sinners." But Jesus answered them, and catch the irony in his voice, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." That's from Luke 5, 31 to 32. Jesus did a remarkable thing when he was in Samaria. In John 4, 39 to 41, he talked with a number of Samaritans from Sychar who knew the woman and at their urging stayed with them for 2 days. He gladly met the woman's friends and acquaintances. Besides that, he must have slept in their beds, eaten their food, talked to them far into the night. It was unthinkable, but Jesus always broke barriers. He refused to consider what mere tradition said. These people mattered to him. They weren't just a few more statistics. Verse 41 puts it, because of his words, many more became believers. To contact others socially, we may need to go out of our usual path, altering our own plans, as Jesus did with the Samaritans. What's more, it may take this to break down barriers. But what better way to express the love of Jesus Christ and demonstrate how much we value others? 2. Establish common ground. The second principle builds on the first. We must take the time to establish common ground as a bridge for communication. We Christians tend to poo-poo anything that calls for much time and preliminary preparation. We like to skip the non-essentials and get right to the point. Preludes are a waste of time, or so we think. Let's give them the message, we insist, impatiently. However, most people resent being trapped in a one-way conversation by those who move in and expound their favorite theme without even bothering to find out if their listeners are interested. We would resent it too. High pressure makes us question whether people care about us as individuals or whether we're just a project to them. We've all been the victim of people who only want to hear themselves give their favorite speech. One friend came into my study and saw a file marked Christian Work. Now he kids me, jokingly I hope, about whether I have a folder with his name on it. We laugh about it together, but he has in times met people who made him feel like a Christian obligation that he was working off. Use sensitivity mixed with grace, as the scripture says. Jesus was a master at relating to others. Were he here today, he would certainly decry the oddballism we have seen in some power-hungry, money-grabbing Christian celebrities. Flamboyant behavior may attract curiosity momentarily, but it both gives a caricature of true Christianity and discourages serious consideration of its message. Jesus did not call us to be strange. The public display of an erroneous picture of Christianity can be our opportunity to start a good discussion. We can decry this kind of untrue picture, and we can go on to explain who Jesus really was and what he came for. We cannot, in any case, let these poor representatives of Jesus Christ defeat us. We need to foster a positive description that will prompt individuals to probe deeper and discover what Christianity is all about. Well, let's look further at this passage. John 4, 7 and 8, when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. If I had been Jesus Christ, Lord of the universe, Paul Little writes, I probably would have blurted out to the woman at the very beginning, lady, do you know who I am? But Jesus didn't approach her that way. He began by making a request. Would she draw him some water? Notice the woman's reaction. You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For the Jews do not associate with Samaritans. This request for a drink doesn't seem very dramatic until we see the whole picture. The mere fact that Jesus spoke to this woman at all was highly unusual. By this simple act, he demolished social, religious, and racial political barriers. As a man, he spoke to her, a woman. As a rabbi, he spoke to her, an immoral woman. As a Jew, he spoke to her, a Samaritan. Thus, he startled her. While she couldn't quite grasp the significance of his words, she could sense a deeper dimension in his life. He refused to discriminate against her. He accepted her. This is lifestyle evangelism personified. For this woman, Jesus' mere request was a treasured compliment. It put them on common ground. In the same way, bridge building with our acquaintances must have a mutuality about it. Sometimes your friendship may start when you ask your neighbor's help or advice. One close friend chides me with, I don't always want to be a helpee. Let me help you. Any friendship must be a two-way street of mutual give and take. It may mean actively seeking opportunities to show love by running errands, helping with a yard project, babysitting, and allowing the other person to do the same for you. Our society overvalues self-sufficiency. By allowing others to do for you, you're telling them that you are willing to let down the defenses to be vulnerable with them. This will give them the option of doing the same with you, perhaps about spiritual matters. Can't you see Jesus with his water gourd in hand directing the conversation first to this known interest, the water in the well, and then to a spiritual reality about which the woman knew nothing? He did all this by means of questions. Jesus was a pro at asking effective questions. It's a skill we would all do well to learn. In his conversation with a lawyer, Jesus began by asking, "What's written in the law? How do you read it?" Luke 10:26. He got the man talking. Another time when the Pharisees challenged him about paying taxes, he took a coin in his hand and asked, "Whose portrait is this on the coin?" Matthew 22:20. To the rich ruler who wanted to know how to get eternal life, Jesus asked, "Why do you call me good?" Luke 18:19. He drew people out with questions, listened to their answers, and then gently gave them his message. I found it helps to use questions to express genuine interest in people. What's more, if I have trouble getting to know people, I try to get out of myself, stop thinking of myself, and think of what might be going on in their lives. A question will often bring that out. Before long, I find that all kinds of things come out, and we're in a deep conversation. I learn what makes them tick. Generally speaking, they will open up if our questions stem from genuine interest. As instruments in God's hands, we can positively and patiently begin first where their interests lie. Later on, we can profitably discuss spiritual matters together. Sometimes common ground isn't as easy to come by. Now, I'm reading from the book How to Give Away Your Faith by Paul E. Little. That's part of this special episode of the Eden Podcast. I'm Bruce C. E. Fleming, a former student of Paul Little, and we worked together. Especially Paul did most of the work, and I benefited greatly, along with many others, at the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization in 1974, on the occasion of Lausanne 4, going on right now in Seoul, Korea. Well, back to Paul, as he says, "My wife and I developed a close friendship with a couple who expressed strong negative feelings about Christianity, and especially Christian workers. As we got to know them, we also discovered they had a wealth of information about flowers and the history of our town. They'd lived in that town since childhood. Although horticulture is not my purple passion in life, far from it, we learned a great deal from them. We took all our questions about gardening to them, and my wife and I listened, and we learned a lot about gardening and about our town as well. Gradually, we established a reciprocal interest in one another. When I would return from a trip, remember now, Paul Little was involved actively with InterVarsity Press. He had spoken on over 400 university campuses, sharing his faith in Jesus and leading many people to the Lord. So when he returned, they would ask, "What were you doing at the University of so-and-so? What did you say to the students? Were they really interested?" And as I answered, I was able to share with them the power and provision of Jesus Christ for each person. It thrilled us to watch their interest grow. When the Billy Graham Crusade came to Chicago, nearby, our neighbors asked if they might go along with us to an evening service. I had a secret feeling that if we had invited them first, they might have resented it and refused to go. We had tried to listen long enough to be sensitive to where they were in their spiritual journey before we even brought up Jesus Christ. And all those hours talking about flowers were very worthwhile because the process built a trust between us, and without that trust, there can be no real relationship and very little effective witnessing. 3, arouse interest. As we read on in John 4, we find ourselves asking, how did the Lord Jesus so perfectly arouse the woman's interest and turn the conversation to his message? He was plainly in control of the situation. Let's read further as Jesus talks to the woman at the well. In John 4, from verses 10 to 15, Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his flocks and herds. Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water." "Give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." I always get moved by that. Jesus loved her. He drew her. He drew us. He drew me. And he wants to draw others through us. Paul Little continues, "It's fascinating to see this woman's curiosity kindled and begin to burn as Jesus drew her along. His treatment of her certainly contributed to the very positive response she had to him and his message of truth. In following our Lord's example, we can turn small events in our relationships to a conversation about spiritual things. A neighbor said to my nephew and his wife, 'I've been watching your family and your three young girls, and I like to see what is coming out of your house.' Well, they took this opportunity to talk about some guidelines the Bible gives for family living. Seemingly, small things can open doors for a verbal witness. It is possible to learn how to be assertive, tasteful speakers for the Lord without being obnoxious. To get started, we can buzz the landing field with some words that could direct the conversation and see if there's any response. Jesus did this when he teased the Samaritan woman into asking a question. He mentioned thirst, and she responded immediately. Once the non-Christian takes the first step in showing some response to us, it takes the pressure off of us. Then we can pick up the conversation later with simple phrases like, 'I was thinking about the conversation we had yesterday,' or 'Something I read reminded me about what you said yesterday,' or 'What were you thinking when you said yesterday?' There would be no pressure or embarrassment in raising the subject again. On the other hand, if we are forcing the person against increasing resistance, we tend to do far more harm than good. Remember how Jesus gently led the conversation. We cannot create spiritual interest in others' lives, even though we might like to. Only the Holy Spirit can do this. However, we can be instruments in his hand to uncover the interest that he has put there. We will discover there are people who are interested in spiritual reality. We don't have to force ourselves on those who are not interested. It's an enormous relief when we discover that we can legitimately drop the subject when there's obviously no response. Relieved of the tension of forced conversation with an unwilling listener, we can bring up the subject later. Confident of the Lord's guidance, we will be natural as we introduce spiritual things. In our witnessing, we ought to be as relaxed in our tone of voice and demeanor as we are when we're discussing last night's ball game, a physics assignment, a small boy's exploits, or our next vacations. All the people I know who have been used of God in personal evangelism have expected to discover interested people. In any group of people or in conversation with any particular individual, they ask themselves, 'Lord, is this one in whom you are working?' Then as the Spirit gives opportunity, they proceed to test the waters. Get the ball rolling. The question is, how do we get the ball rolling? Jesus did it by making a cryptic statement that precipitated a question from the Samaritan woman. His statement related to her primary needs and at the same time suggested his ability and willingness to meet those needs. John 4, 10 and 11. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob?" We can begin witnessing by either making a statement or by asking a leading question. Jesus started by mentioning the gift of God. He also anticipated the woman's reactions. Her questions did not catch him off guard even once. To take full advantage of each opportunity, we also need to consider beforehand the likely responses. As we think about possible situations, let's think through how to get the ball rolling and how to handle these responses. Even after a vague reference to religion in a conversation, many Christians have used this practical series of three questions to draw out latent spiritual interest. Question number one: "By the way, Are you interested in spiritual things? Some will answer yes, but even if the people say no, we can still proceed. What do you think a real Christian is? Wanting to hear people's opinions invariably pleases them. From their responses, we'll also gain a more accurate and even shocking understanding of their thinking as non-Christians. Besides, they'll be much more ready to listen to us because we have listened to them. Answers to this question usually revolve around some external action. Going to church, reading the Bible, praying, tithing, being baptized. After such an answer, we can agree that real Christians usually do these things, but we can then point out that it's not what real Christians are. Real Christians relate to Jesus Christ as a living person. Then real Christians want to do the things just mentioned. If the non-Christian continues to indicate interest as we explain this, we can go on to the third question. Would you like to become a real Christian now? An amazing number of people today are drifting in a spiritual fog, yearning for someone to lead them into spiritual certainty. It's common for the discussion to turn to going to church or even being raised in a church. Well, this is the opportunity to say, you have probably found the same thing is true in your church as in mine. Some people who go there know Jesus Christ personally. Some do not. Church membership in any denomination does not in itself guarantee really knowing God. This conversation snippet gives us opportunity to discuss the difference between a religious background or even a religious attitude and knowing Jesus Christ personally. If we're on the ball, we can seize many other opportunities to throw out a leading comment. But we frequently lose out in the art of repartee by thinking of the appropriate comment an hour later. So plan ahead for those common remarks in everyday conversation that can be easily spoken for the Lord. Another means of getting the ball rolling is to be alert for opportunities to share about our spiritual experiences. As we get close to people as friends, they will begin to confide in us about their burdens, their longings, aspirations, frustrations, and emptiness. As they tell us these things, we can say quietly if our experience was similar, "You know, I used to feel that until I had an experience that completely changed my outlook on life. Would you like me to tell you about it?" By making a cryptic statement and offering, rather than forcing our experience on them, we prevent others from feeling that we're just unloading unsolicited goods at their doorsteps. If they ask to hear about our experience, we should be ready to speak, briefly, emphasizing the reality of Christ to us today, and eliminating boring and probably irrelevant details. We should simply say what Christ means to us now. Suppose our experience cannot parallel the ones described to us by our non-Christian friends. What do we say? We know Christ is a reality to us today, so we can say, "You know, I would feel that way, except for an experience that changed my outlook on life. Would you like me to tell you about it?" Those of us who have grown up in Christian homes and churches often develop an inferiority complex because we can't point to a dramatic change in our lives when we became Christians. We can't say, "Well, once I was a dope addict, but see what Christ has done for me." If we came to new life in Christ as a child, we probably did not notice much of a change in our lives. We need not feel inferiority or apologetic about this, as though somehow our experience were not as genuine as the more spectacular. The Apostle Paul's conversion was wonderfully dramatic, but we must always remember that Timothy's was just as real. From early childhood, he heard the word of God from his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. We read that in 2 Timothy 1:5. The great question for us is whether Jesus Christ really is a dynamic Lord to us today. There are passages in people's lives that draw their attention to religion and give us wide open opportunities to get the ball rolling. For students, academic failure, disappointment in love, or concern about career choices may open the door. For young couples, the birth of a first child may turn their thoughts to religious training. As families grow, teenage problems can cause the parents to despair. Physical problems, emotional turmoil, and financial reverses bring special fears. Divorces are particularly traumatic. We can use any one of these situations to bring up the need for God. When our neighbor phoned and said her husband had a heart attack, I prayed with her on the phone. My wife brought the family supper. Since then, I've given her a book to read. One woman called our home because she wanted to know if she should build a new house or stay in the old one. When my wife talked to her, she told her that in a very difficult time in her life, Jesus Christ had given her peace and wisdom. This woman, obviously prepared by the Holy Spirit, responded, I want that. The next day, we sat in our family room and read Bible passages to her and talked with her. She literally pleaded with us to help her commit her life to Jesus Christ. Not everyone is so eager and ready. She was moved and made a commitment to the Lord who would guide her in all her life choices. I can still remember the joy we felt reading to her, greater love has no one than this, that Jesus lay down his life for his friends. John 15:13. Again, we may be talking about a question relating to church or some religious activity. If we handle it properly, we can arouse interest in the gospel. A question I'm often asked when I'm traveling is, what kind of work do you do? I used to reply matter-of-factly, I'm a staff member for InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. That answer took the conversation nowhere. Then someone suggested to me that answers describing activity or function always tell more than a mouthful of proper names and titles. So now I explain my work instead. I talk to students about how Jesus Christ relates to everyday life. This is more likely to bring the response, well, that sounds interesting. It is, I say. Just the other night, I was talking to a student who said, and I briefly give the gist of an actual conversation. Then I asked, by the way, are you interested in spiritual things? And the conversation is off and running. In a discussion about the day's headlines, the latest world crisis, or some other current event, the query, what do you think is wrong with the world, may be appropriate. After listening, while various external causes are blamed for mankind's problems, we can say, I've gotten help from what Jesus Christ said about this. At times like this, if the person is still interested, I try to refer to Jesus's diagnosis of human nature, that we're alienated from God, in Mark 7:21-23. People themselves, because of their inner attitudes, are the basic problem. As G.K. Chesterton put it aptly, what is wrong with the world? I'm wrong with the world. And the only solution to the I problem is Jesus Christ, who has promised to give us a new life and a new purpose for life. Books and booklets on provocative subjects provide another possibility for stimulating conversation on spiritual matters. One family near us had three rambunctious boys, ages 3, 4, and 5. They were always talking about the difficulties they struggled with in rearing those boys. One day I loaned them two books on child rearing written from a Christian perspective. After that, I had no problem discussing Jesus Christ with them. We've also had some interesting conversations that started with friends browsing among the books we have in our living room. We have an array of secular books of various kinds and some special Christian books. We encourage people to borrow them. It gives us the opening to say, I'd be interested in your reaction to this one. As a rule, when I travel, I carry two booklets with me. Two good ones are Christianity for the Open-Minded by Michael Cassidy and Becoming a Christian by John R. W. Stott. After any conversation, I might offer one of them, saying, this little book has helped me. Would you like to have it? If it is a one-time conversation, it is at least the possibility that something the person can consider later on by themselves. Sometimes we can get the ball rolling by inviting people to a small group Bible study at home or in church. If the atmosphere is low-key and non-threatening, I found good response from people who are thinking about God, or even from those who may be lonely and would welcome an intimate group of any kind. It can be an excellent vehicle for making the facts about Jesus Christ clear. There are two basic things that make such a group effective. The first is an atmosphere that does not make beginners feel either like targets or children who know nothing. If the group is a discussion group, this usually helps. Then people can express their doubts and questions freely. The second thing is to have a definite plan for the subject matter to be studied, including a specific time frame. For beginners, sometimes just a 6-week study is attractive, or a study in the book of Mark for 16 weeks. In such studies, I have often seen complete agnostics change to roundly affirm the facts of Jesus' claims. Then, over coffee, their personal commitment can be talked out. Other group events, such as music concerts or Christian films, help the person get the feel of a group of Christians together. A vital group of turned-on Christians can open the coldest hearts. What's more, wherever possible, we want inquirers to eventually join other believers when they commit themselves to the Lord. We're not looking for decisions only. We're praying for people who will wholeheartedly follow Jesus Christ and grow into mature Christians. In these and similar situations, having a few things in mind to say beforehand will help overcome our nervousness. If we clutch, others clutch. But if we relax, they relax. Any tendency to be apologetic about our faith is easily detected. When we assume people lack interest, we tend to defeat ourselves before we start. On the other hand, if we assume interest, we are more likely to get a positive response. As we gain in quiet confidence, the Holy Spirit will lead us to interested people. Each successful encounter with a non-Christian will lead us to greater faith and confidence for the next one. Now, I'm reading to you from the book How to Give Away Your Faith by Paul Little, on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization. Well, actually, it's a year or two beyond that now. 50th anniversary, let's think back. Was in 1974. Yeah, okay, 50 years ago. I was a participant in the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization back then. I had no idea that one day we would be co-founding, my wife and I, the Tru316 Foundation. Our website is tru316.com, tru316.com. I had no idea what would happen as a result of that Congress. At that Congress, in a side meeting, I was invited to a group of African leaders who were deciding on which city to place their very first graduate seminary for African leaders in French-speaking Africa. That led step by step to our going overseas and actually teaching at the Bangui Evangelical Graduate School of Theology. Things you just never knew were coming, but the Lord did. Back to section five, or the fifth step in giving away your faith, Paul Little writes, "Don't go too far." The next part of our Lord's conversation reveals principles five and six. Give people only as much of the message as they are ready for, and don't condemn them. We're continuing with our quote now from the scripture in John 4. Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him or her will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You were right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you're a prophet." John 4:13-19. Despite the woman's obvious interest and curiosity, Jesus didn't give her the whole story at once. Gradually, as she was ready for more, he revealed more about himself. Then, when her curiosity had reached fever pitch in verse 26, he identified himself as the long-awaited Messiah. The moment we detect a faint glimmer of interest in non-Christians, many of us want to rush right in and rattle off the whole gospel without coming up for air or waiting for any audience response. After all, we might not get another chance, we think. But by relying on the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, we can gain poise. Non-Christians need gentle coaxing when they're just beginning to show interest. It's usually fragile at first. Otherwise, like birds scared from their perches by a sudden movement toward them, they'll withdraw. On the other hand, if we're casual in our attitude and relaxed in our manner, the inquirers might even press us to share with them. Along with this, in your explanation of the Christian faith, start by finding out what basic things you can agree on. Do they really believe in God? What do they think God is like? Is he out to get them? Who do they think Jesus is? Do they have any favorite passages in the Bible? Don't assume that they're totally ignorant. Search for a basis to build on. Affirm these things roundly where you can. In my early days, I zoomed in at the start with the idea of correcting. That is, correcting their theology. "Hey, let me tell you what's wrong with universalism." Just my know-it-all attitude was a turnoff. Nobody listens to a know-it-all. Regardless of how many people we meet, Generally speaking, they fall into one of two groups. Those in the first group lack information about Jesus Christ and wouldn't know how to become a Christian if they wanted to. The second group of people have all the information necessary and need only to respond to that information. With this second group, it doesn't help to thump them with the gospel every time we see them. Once we're satisfied in our minds that certain persons fully understand the gospel, it's usually best to drop the subject until they introduce it. In the meantime, we must not separate ourselves from them in any way, but continue to love them and pray earnestly that they come into the kingdom of God. I had a young friend who had come with us to Bible studies for a while and read a couple of Christian books. He had a good grasp of the Christian message. One night we went to a Christian film together and afterward went out for coffee. It was evident that the Spirit of God had touched him, but I could sense that his old wall of resistance was still there. This time I decided not to talk about Jesus Christ with him unless he brought up the subject. Finally, he burst out with some heat in his voice. "I'm not going to become a Christian, you know." The only thing I could think of was, "Well, that's your choice." He already had all the information he needed. Now the choice was his. I had a clear sense that it would have been useless for me to continue to press for any commitment. At least then. It's helpful to remember that comprehending spiritual truth is no small thing. Just to grasp the idea of God becoming human is mind-wrenching, profound exercise in thought. Let the divine truths sink deeply into the mind and heart of your friends. It may take considerable time. In our church, there's a mature woman who is a relatively recent Christian, but who has grown like wildfire and teaches Bible classes. She often tells how she didn't really grasp how much of a sinner she was until 6 months after her conversion. Go slowly and let the Spirit lead. So we come up to the sixth point, don't condemn. In the sixth principle, we see that Jesus Christ did not condemn the woman. As she answered his question about her husband, her sin itself condemned her. He didn't bypass the question about her husband's, but he did no finger pointing or head wagging in judgment. In another similar incident with a woman caught in adultery who was brought to Jesus, he said to her pointedly, "Neither do I condemn you. Now, go and leave your life of sin." That's from John chapter 8, verse 11. Most of us in either of these situations would have been quick to condemn. It's probably because we have the mistaken idea that if we do not condemn a certain attitude or deed, we will be condoning it. But this was not our Lord's way. Christians cannot be unmoved in the presence of sin that clearly separates from God and is self-destructive. This sin is what brought Jesus Christ here to earth to give his life. We must express pain and sorrow. There's no way to be joyful when we are confronted with destructive sin. The rub comes when we feel personally revolted by the filth of sin, but want to love the person. Pain and warmth can be expressed at the same time. Sternness and warmth cannot. I'm awed by the picture of the divine, holy Son of God standing in front of an exceedingly sinful woman, expressing love and forgiveness. "I don't condemn you. There is forgiveness. There's a better way." Joy and encouragement comes when we turn from sin, go and sin no more, and are bathed in that forgiveness. Although we may never have been caught in obvious sins as these women were, our own need for forgiveness must never be forgotten. Our message is never that we're good and moral and we want everyone else to be good like us. We can never discuss another sin without putting ourselves in the same position of needing help and forgiveness. What's more, we can never let our own less flagrant sins cease to revolt us while we openly are horrified with someone else's more obvious evil. Even the Apostle Paul often stated that he was the grossest of sinners. A good rule to follow in all our relationships is the simple quip, "Well, you can catch more flies with honey than vinegar." Not only must we avoid condemning people, we need to learn the art of legitimate compliment. Many people are deeply touched by a genuine compliment. Criticism sometimes can be far more natural to our lips than praise, but praise can make others more open to the gospel. Charles Trumbull asserts that we can discover in any person at least one thing worthy of an honest compliment. To prove his point, he describes one of his own experiences on a train. A cursing, drunken man staggered into his car on a train. After lurching into the seat beside Mr. Trumbull, he offered him a swallow from his flask. Mr. Trumbull inwardly recoiled from the man, but instead of blasting the man about his condition, he replied, No, thank you, but I can see you're a very generous man. The man's eyes lit up, despite his drunken stupor, and the two men began to talk. That day, the man heard Christ's claims. He was deeply touched, and later, he came to the Savior. Principle number 7, stick with the main issue. As the interview between our Lord and the Samaritan woman draws to a close, we note 2 final principles that apply to our witnessing conversations. And we get this from John 4, verses 20 to 26. So I'm reading all of this. It's part of the book by Paul Little, How to Give Away Your Faith. The woman at the well is saying to Jesus, "Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus declared, "Believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he." Our Lord did not allow any secondary questions to sidetrack him from the main issue. The woman asked where she should worship, on Mount Gerizim or in Jerusalem. But Jesus steered the discussion back to himself by shifting the emphasis from where to how one worships. Though the woman's question was probably valid, our Lord refused to go off on a tangent. Her attitude was similar to the current honest question that many people have. Well, which church should I join? Or we might be asked about hypocrites in the church, errors, supposedly, in the Bible. Why are there so many denominations? And a multitude of other questions. Any legitimate question can be a tangent if it sidetracks us from the main issue. Jesus left no doubt about the main issue, himself. The central message of reconciliation must never be left out of our witness. When we are confronted with people involved in especially repulsive acts, call to mind how the Lord Jesus approached the woman in Samaria. And remember, his attitude toward the two men, Levi and Zacchaeus, both of them tax cheats. When men and women of all kinds meet Jesus Christ, their lives are changed. There's that song about Zacchaeus that closes in one beautiful line with the message we want to convey. And so he came, and transformation was his aim. Principle number 8, confront the person directly. And finally, in declaring to the Samaritan woman that he was the Messiah, Jesus reached the crucial point of his message to her. "I who speak to you am he." Likewise, whether we spend one or many sessions with friends building bridges of friendship, we must eventually cross this bridge and bring the non-Christians into a direct confrontation with the Lord Jesus so that they realize their personal responsibility to decide for or against him. Effective ambassadors must know how to invite a decision about the message they are communicating. Now, there are a number of people who know how to build bridges of friendship, take initiative in conversation, and get across the message, but they are completely flummoxed when it comes to helping people across the line. How do you find out whether people are ready without being too abrupt? The simple answer is, you ask them. How do we ask them? For a period of time, I used to say to people, "Are you a Christian?" But I discovered that wasn't the best way to go about it for several reasons. In the first place, a great many people would say yes, thinking they knew what being a Christian was all about. Soon I was quite sure in the light of the New Testament that they weren't Christians. But once you get a yes answer to that question, you have a problem. You can't say, I'm sorry, friend, you're all wrong for the following reasons. Somehow they don't appreciate that kind of thing. People have a right to believe anything they choose to believe, but they don't have the right to redefine Christianity. Only Jesus Christ has the right and authority to state the terms of Christianity. A series of questions I learned from Leith Samuel from Southampton, England, when he was here lecturing years ago, have been worth their weight in gold to me. Here they are. First one, have you ever personally trusted Jesus Christ, or are you still on the way? Immediately, this question defines clearly what a Christian is, and beyond that, it lets the person know that you're prepared for a negative response without being shocked. It's very common to have a person respond with, you know, that's exactly how you describe me. I'm still on the way. Next question. That's interesting. How far along the way are you? This second question follows up the first one and draws people out more fully. It's absolutely amazing how often I've had people explain to me without the slightest hesitation or embarrassment how far down the road of their spiritual pilgrimage they are. And that's tremendously valuable information to have. Once we hear them tell us where they are, we can fill in any gaps they may need. Our objective, of course, is to find out where people are and try to help them down the road a bit further. The next question, would you like to become a real Christian and be sure of it? I proceed to this third question if people indicate any response, and frequently they will. Again, let me emphasize the amazing number of people who are just waiting to be asked, who are longing for spiritual certainty, but no one has ever told them how to get it. So perhaps you can say to people that you've witnessed to and had some discussions with, by the way, have you ever personally trusted Christ, or are you still on the way? How far along the way are you? Would you like to become a real Christian and be sure of it? These, then, are our eight principles. Meet and know non-Christians personally. Establish a mutual interest in conversation. Arouse a person's interest by life and word. Gear explanations to people's receptiveness and readiness for more. Accept and even compliment rather than condemn. Stay on the track. And persevere to the destination. Once we begin to grasp these principles and move out in faith, life becomes a daily fascination. We watch with anticipation to see the next opportunities God will give us to bear witness as ambassadors of Jesus Christ and to discover how He's working in the lives of others through us. This is Bruce C.E. Fleming. I had the privilege to personally have this author, Paul Little, as my professor and mentor. I was even going to be working with him in his office. We were going to share that. A year after the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization, we were supposed to share an office together in the School of World Mission and Evangelism in Deerfield, Illinois. 3 weeks before we were supposed to meet up and start, I had a phone call with the terrible news that Paul had been in an accident in Canada and had lost his life. But Paul has left us this inheritance. The work that he did as program director of the Lausanne Congress on World Evangelization in 1974. Several other books that he wrote, like Know What You Believe and Know Why You Believe. And this one that I've been reading from, How to Give Away Your Faith.